Hello. Welcome again. What I was saying, but maybe nobody heard me, was that in the previous talks, I had some questions, and I wanted to ask something, and then they say, oh, there's time for one question, and I was a bit disappointed. So I try my best to finish a bit early, and I also try to be a little bit provocative, which is not at all my nature. That was a joke. So that we maybe get a bit of discussion. Oh, hang on, I'm in the wrong slide. Okay, the title of this talk is The Power of Pi, by the way. This is a big pi, capital pi. And I will explain where the pi comes from. And I should also say I stole this title from a paper of some of my students. Yes, that's that. Okay, so here I saw this picture on Facebook a while ago, and I really liked it because I think it describes very, very well this sort of tension between dynamic and static typing. And I'm a type theory person, so you would think I'm really very much static. But actually, as some people know, there was just a workshop on education with functional programming, TFPy, and I gave a talk there about teaching Python. And Python, obviously, is dynamically typed. So I do actually think there is a point in using dynamic typing, especially for beginners, because you don't have to explain them the static semantics. But as we see, they end up with some funny programs or funny puzzle solutions. And static typing is a bit harder, but it pays off in the long run. Now, let's look at some programming languages. I tried to make a very rough classification here. So C is static. It's not dynamic at all. But weak, so what do I mean by weak? I mean you can cheat, right? You can coerce an object to a different object, and whatever happens, happens. And you're a bit on your own. In contrast, languages like Java or C#, they have a mix, actually, between static and dynamic, but they're usually strong, so you can't really change the representation. But they are dynamic, meaning, what does it mean, actually? I think these languages have an interesting combination of static and dynamic typing. And the dynamic part usually comes via inheritance. So you get message not understood, which is a dynamic type error. In a way, to me, it almost seems that the real point of object-oriented programming is really this mix between dynamic and static typing. And maybe the whole propaganda about object-oriented programming is really a bit much, and what it really is about is that you have dynamic typing well integrated with static typing. Now, languages like Python, which I already mentioned, or Scheme, they are completely dynamic. Everything is, even addition can go wrong because you try to add to things which are not integers or not don't fit. But they're also strong, so you usually can't cheat with the representation. And finally, languages like Haskell or SML, they go the whole way, right? There's really no dynamic typing in this sense. They're completely static and completely strong. Now, here is my observation. Haskell, and that's intended to be provocative. So Haskell's type system is not up to the job. It's a very interesting challenge, I think, to have a language which has a static, strong type system, but Haskell's type system isn't up to the job. And you see this, actually, it's not just Haskell. I mean, by Haskell, I mean languages like Haskell. It's not up to the job, and you see this by sort of lots of ad hoc, or not ad hoc, lots of extensions of Haskell, or lots of things which people try to do, which don't fit in, and then they add one more extension to the type system. But The question is, maybe there's something fundamentally wrong, right? I mean, it's like you have a wheel with three corners, and you know you discover that you could have four corners, and it's a bit better, but maybe there's something fundamentally wrong about having a wheel with corners, right? Okay. So, and my point is, the solution or the wheel, the round thing, are actually dependent types. Now, let me try to present at least some evidence. And let me first explain what are dependent types. Now, I don't actually want to do this because I was here last year. I actually was in the small lecture theater. And I gave a bit of a tutorial on dependent types. So I don't really want to give the same talk again. Now, obviously, maybe they're not. Who was in my talk last year? OK. There are some people, so I don't want to repeat myself. But I thought I should give a reference, because there is, which I think is the penultimate talk about dependent types, which wasn't mine. It's a bit longer ago. And this is Connor McBride's talk, which was called Winging It. I'm not really sure why it was called Winging It. And it's like around 2000. And I mean, who has seen talks by Connor McBride? Yeah, funny? Yeah, entertaining? Okay. So like 20 years ago, we didn't have these digital projectors. In the old days, you had to really write on slides. And Connor was a master of it. He had these slides with overlays, and they were glued together, and he would really produce some almost like a animation using all these slides. So this art has been lost. But he has actually, he has scanned in all his overlays, and you can find them on the internet. And what he was presenting is the idea that dependent types are a bit like a proletarian revolution, right? So you have the colon in the middle, and there's this old established social order with the workers are on the left, and you see the workers are red, and they do all the work, and they can be inspected. And on the right-hand side of the colon, there are the types. And the types never do any work, and they cannot be inspected, yeah? But they control the workers, the terms, yeah, on the left-hand side. And there's no riffraff. There's nobody is going through this colon, yeah? And the types don't really know very much about work, about what the terms are doing, yeah? Like this one says, I've never seen a spade. But now, there comes this revolution, which is called dependent types, and the terms, they walk through the colon from the left to the right, right? And you could imagine, possibly, that the types are running away in terror, right? And then that's it. But in reality, there is a much nicer solution. The types are actually quite happy to meet the terms, you know, and they say, ah, that's what a spade is, yeah? And they have a much better understanding of what the terms are doing, right? And a much more precise way to talk about the terms, right? So yeah, I recommend to have a look at this talk, at these slides. There are many more, and they're all like this. So I wouldn't say much more about dependent types, but I thought I should explain the title of my talk, which says pi. So where does the capital pi comes from? I mean, it's not a small pi, so it has nothing to do with circles. The pi types are actually dependent function types, and here's a very trivial example. So if I have a function which for every positive integer, every natural number, produces a list of this length, right? And using dependent types, we can talk about lists of a certain length. They're called vector. Then it's a dependent function, right? Because the output depends on the input. So it's in Acta, we use like the normal function type, the arrow notation, but the left-hand side can bind a variable. Now, dependent function types are also called pi types. and a different sort of more traditional notation for a dependent function type is what you see down there. It's a pi type, which the domain of the pi type is just a subscript, and then the codomain. And why do we use pi? So I thought if you can take nothing else out of this talk, maybe at least I can explain where the pi in the pi type, in the dependent function type, comes from. And here is my explanation. Let's look at as an example, a finite function. The function, so fin of n is a type which has n elements. Yeah, so fin of 0 is empty, fin of 1 has just 0, and so on. Now, we could have a function from fin of 3, 0, 1, 2, till the natural numbers. So for example, f of 0 could be 2, f of 1 could be 3, and f of 2 could be 4. Now, how many functions are there from fin of 3 to fin of f of x? Yeah? So you give it an input, a number between 0 and 2, 0, 1, 2, and the output is a fin of given by this function. So fin of 0 has 2 elements, f of 1 has 3 elements, and f of 2 has 4 elements. So if you think about it, if you think about the number of choices, they're exactly 2 times 3 times 4. Yeah? So basically, what you get is you get the normal pi as the generalized product. So dependent function types are really a form of a generalized product because you multiply all the domains with each other. Does it make sense, or was it a bit too short? Yeah. So pi type, dependent function type, is really a big product, an infinite product. And that's why you use pi in the sense of product. And the same explanation also works for sigma types, which are dependent pairs. And if you think of what a dependent pair is, it's really a big sum, right? OK. Don't know whether this worked. OK. So what is the power of pi now? That's the title of the talk. OK. So here is one example. I find sometimes you have good programs, maybe programs you can write in your dynamic typing environment. And now you want to give them, you want to turn them into a statically typed program. But you can't because your statically typed system is not good enough to capture all your good programs. Yeah? So the example I've given here is very old. It's just printf, right? Printf gets a string, and then what comes after depends on the string, right? Depending on whether you use, let's say, person D or person S or whatever, depending on this format string, determines what are the remaining arguments. So there's a clear dependency between the first argument and the arguments which come after. And this can be very nicely or very naturally expressed as a dependent function type. So now there is a natural objection. People may say, however, the latest Haskell extension will handle this. We can do this. We have data kinds. We have strings which live on the type level, so maybe that's enough. And yes, you can do things like printf, which I've given there, but the requirement now is that the strings are static, so are actually type level strings, and I call this a pre-Newtonian version of dependent types, because if you think about it, so Newton, before Newton, they had different laws about the heaven and the earth, right? The heaven, everything is always moving, and earth, everything stops. And to me, this idea is like this type level values mean you have natural numbers, you have numbers, and there are different numbers on earth and in heaven, so there are different numbers on the level of terms and on the level of types. But in a way, that seems to be quite unnatural because the only thing which you should have are numbers. Yeah? And there are actually, I mean, there are use cases where this sort of static, very static view of type level values breaks down. They really need to be more dynamic. OK. then there are lots of examples here. And I thought they were all a bit too complicated to present, so I opted, as I say, okay, here's the situation. You have a record where the first part determines the structure of the remaining part. So maybe there's some numbers, some sizes, or some choices of types. And in the beginning, you give the scheme, and later you give the data, but the data depends on the scheme. So depending on which scheme you choose, it could be like a format string, you have different data. So for example, a database has a scheme and has some content which depends on the scheme. And this is actually a case for sigma type, you know, where you have a dependent product where one part of the data depends on the other. So that's the power of sigma in this case. I should have said in my title, the power of big Greek letters or something. Then here is a very well-known application of dependent types. So for example, if we have a type of matrices and we want to, which we can define as a vector of vectors, and we want to implement matrix multiplication, then it's clear that for the function to work, the matrices, the sizes have to match. If they don't match, you get a runtime error. But you want to eliminate, you want to be statically rule out these runtime errors. You cannot get this type, basically, of matrix multiplication. Okay, in Haskell, the error is built in, but if you're really honest, you would just get a maybe type. So maybe you get a matrix, but if the sizes don't match, then you don't really know what to do. Okay, then here's another application of dependent types in programming, actually gradual typing. So gradual typing says, so sometimes you want to use dynamic typing, and sometimes you want to use, you refine your program, it develops, you want to use static typing. Now, how can you integrate these two? You can have extension of your type system which allows dynamic types. My claim is if you have dependent types, you already have dynamics. So dynamic type in a dependently typed language, you need a universe of types. You can syntactically inspect your types. And then for every type, you can assign, here's called a set, which is basically the type of values. So these are called universes in type theory. And if you have one of these universes, then you can form a type of dynamic values, where every value is a pair of a type and an associated value. And this makes it possible to implement a dynamic type discipline within your dependently typed system and integrate it with a static type discipline. So here I give some reasons why dependent types, I think, can be useful in programming. And there are more, and a famous use case of dependent types is formal verification, proposition as types. And I left this out this time because I really wanted to emphasize the use of dependent types in programming. Yeah? So even if you don't believe or if you're not excited about formal verification, even in sort of programming, there are lots of cases, use cases for dependent types. So now, the question which arises is, if dependent types are so great, why is not everybody using them? I don't know. I don't know why Donald Trump is elected either. So, yes, to address this, maybe I wanted to collect, there are what I would call myths about dependent types. And there are some facts. And I mean, facts, why dependent types are maybe not so completely easy. Yeah? What are the obstacles of DTP? So here's what I would call the first myth, that programming in a dependently typed language is somehow difficult. Very difficult. One remark is that a polymorphic type system like Haskell's is really a sub-language. So in a polymorphism, from a dependency type view, is a particular kind of dependency where you depend on type, on set. Yeah? It's a particular kind of dependency, which means that ordinary polymorphic programs are a sub-language, subsystem of a dependency type system. So basically, if you use a dependency type system, you don't have to use dependent types. You can just stick to the Haskell types, or the Haskell programs all the time. But at some point, you think, OK, hang on, I could be more precise here. I could really put more into my types. I could put more condition. I don't want to fail here. So if you put more in, you have to also work harder. But I think that's fair. I mean, what do you expect? If you really want to get more out, you have to put more in. But it's a pay-as-you-go situation. So yes, it can be harder to work with dependent types. But if you want more, then you have to put more in. It's not really the fault of the language or the type system. Then the second myth, which I think is quite widespread, that you always have to prove that your function, your program is terminating, or terminating, I should say total. Yeah, I just criticize this use of, I'm using it myself, I criticize myself, I should have said total. Yeah, so this is a myth, I would say. I mean, OK, there are lots of people, especially, for example, Connor, who really insist on writing total programs. And I would say, actually, I want to have total programs. I want my program to be total, because a program which is not total is basically a buggy program. I don't like them. But on the other hand, so I'm saying good programs are total programs. But it can be quite hard to convince a compiler that your program is total. Now, if you do want to do formal verification, that's quite essential. And I agree with the previous speaker that we need some totality. But if you really want to program, then this isn't always necessary. So you can actually have this, like, the flag, I'm a doctor, believe me, this function is terminating. Yeah? That's not a problem. And most dependency type systems allow you to do this. So there's nothing wrong. However, and maybe that's where this myth comes from, in some cases, actually, knowing that your program is total can allow you to run it faster. Yeah? So it's not essential, but you have to pay a price if you cannot convince the compiler that your program is total, okay? So let me explain this. So let's say I have a vector of length m, but I need a vector of length n. And I have a theorem that m is equal to n. The theorem is just a program, right? It's a program of this particular type, of this equality type. And now I can actually, in a dependency type language, I have this sort of transport, which says, OK, if I have a value of this type and I know they are equal, then I can transport it. So I can transport half into what I need, into n. So I can transport along this equality. Well, that's cool. However, if we don't know that theorem, THM, is terminating, then I need to run it, yeah? Because otherwise I lose type soundness. If THM is a lie, it's bottom, then it's not true, and then doing this coercion breaks my type soundness, right? So if I don't know that THM is terminating, I have to run it until it reduces to a normal form of the equality type, and then I can run the whole program. But if I know that THM is total, I don't need to run it, because I know the only thing which it can evaluate to is REFL, and it will go away. Yeah? So in this case, knowing that my program is total means I can be safe and fast at the same time. Okay? So hence, yes, in a dependency type language, it makes sense to recognize that a program is probably total. But it doesn't mean that all your programs have to be total all the time. But if you use them in this context, then you better proves that they are total. Okay. Now, this is a very common myth, that dependently typed program languages are not Turing complete. And that's really bad, right? Because Turing is a great guy and we want to adhere to him somehow. So there are, I mean, I said before that total programs are good programs, but not all programs can be total, right? Like, which programs cannot be total? Sorry? Interpreter, right. If you write interpreter, even interpreter for language users studying, then it cannot be total, otherwise you get in trouble with Professor Gödel, right? So there are programs which cannot be total. Actually, if you do certain computation on the reals, they cannot be total, because you will have to explore a real infinitely deep, and that doesn't work. So there are cases where you need partiality. But we always know, we know how to deal with effects in a language like Haskell. An effect is a monad, right? And it turns out that partiality is just an monadic effect, and you can actually deal with it like this. So yes, you need an effect. You need partiality as an effect to deal with this. Okay. Oh, here, okay. Talking about effects, here's another myth, that a dependently typed language doesn't really work well with effects. So effects are sort of tricky. I mean, effects like I/O and so on, that they only work for pure functional programs. So that's another myth. And really, the question is, if there is an effect in your program and the compiler executes the effect, does it mean that the compiler runs your program at compile time? And what happens I hope that most people don't work for military applications, but imagine you do, yeah? And you write a missile control system in a dependently typed language, yeah? And now you have the start missiles, which is appearing in your program, and the compiler runs it, and this happens, yeah? So, I mean, really, dependently typed languages are extremely dangerous because they may run effects on compile time, and that's the end of the world as we know it. No, not so. So you can actually integrate effects in dependently typed program, and this is something my student Wouter and I, we worked a while ago, and we made a proposal. We says, okay, what you can have actually at compile time, you have a mathematical semantics, actually semantics as a functional program. Yeah? So for example, this works for this partiality model where you can really write an effect in using dependent types. But at runtime, you really run this partial program. So you have a way to reason or to use the semantics of your effect, whether it's state or whether it's partiality or whatever effect you have or non-determinism. And you can actually use this in your dependently typed program, but you don't actually run it, but you run it at compile time. We call this the beauty in the beast, because actually the beast is the effects, yeah? And actually, in the end, you find that effects can be understood completely functional and can be reasoned about in a completely functional way. There's no need to have a process calculus or any nonsense like this. Okay. So now, let me come to the facts. So I tried to say there's some myths which I think are not really serious obstacles to using dependent types. But there are some facts, there are some issues. So one thing is dependently typed programming makes really big demands on your IDE. Yeah? So for example, you really need incremental interactive typing. Yeah? You cannot, if you work with dependent types seriously, you cannot just type in your program and then run the compiler, because there are too many constraints, too many things to keep track of. You really want to do this interactive in a dialogue, which is why if you look at dependently typed languages, they usually have these sheds, which are part of the program, which isn't yet finished, but you know the type, and then you can interactively refine the program until it's completed. So also, dependently typed IDEs for dependently typed languages usually offer some sort of case splitting. So you say, okay, I want to do case on this. And then you split the cases automatically. And again, there are, the case splitting is getting more complicated, so you really want to have this machine support there. And also, you want to move between what we call implicit and explicit typing. So the point is that, all type information can be made explicit. Even the polymorphism, the instantiation for polymorphism, can be made explicit. But usually you don't want to see it. So you move in, you basically hide type information to make your program readable, but sometimes you want to see it. So you have to move in between hiding types and seeing types. So all these things create special demands on your, IDE. But actually, on the other hand, it turns out that the solutions which have been found are actually useful for programming in general. Even for Haskell programming, I think having these sheds and having automatic case splitting is useful. And I know people who started like writing programs in ACTA, where you have all these features, and then moving back to writing Haskell programs, I say, where is my shed? Where is my question mark? How do I can split cases? So it's actually an evolution in IDEs, which is driven by necessity in this case. Okay, so then compile time can be an issue, which means it can be very, very slow. Now people think the problem is that in a dependently typed system, the compiler may have to run functions at compile time. But it turns out this is not the problem. The problem is that you have to solve more complicated unification problems. And there can be, by making some small changes, you can have a massive loss of sharing, as we know, which is really a killer. It leads to an exponential blow-up. Now, this is an issue, and current systems are not very good at it. And there are situations where people write ACTA programs, and they say, OK, it doesn't type check anymore. I need like a day now. It's not really feasible. Now, I don't think it's a fundamental problem, and there are solutions how to fix this, how to avoid these situations, which are not implemented yet. So I think there is hope that we can address most of these compile time issues, but in the current systems, like ACTA, for example, this is still a problem. There is a real issue. Which has to do with reusability. If you have a more detailed types in your library, you have less, it's very hard to maintain the same level of reusability because all of a sudden you just have not just lists, you have vectors, you have maybe sorted lists, sorted vectors, and so on. And it's more difficult, or it's very difficult, to maintain the same level of reusability. You really have to think you have new ideas. So there's some work by Connors about ornamental algebras which use dependent types again to recover reusability, but it's harder. It's not as easy to reuse your data. And here, the final fact, and then there's a bit of an advertisement as well, is which is maybe the main issue, that the tool chains for professional development using dependent types, they are not there. But now I put in a picture of Edwin Brady, who may disagree in this because he is very much working on fixing this, and he has implemented the language Idris, which is a dependently typed language. It's not the one I use most of the time. I use ACTA, but Idris pays much more emphasis on the tool chain for programmers. Is less sort of maybe principled, less for the type theoretician, but more for the practitioner. And he's also written a book about using dependent types for type-driven development, which I can very much recommend. Okay, here's the summary again. So I identified, or I tried to identify some myths about dependently typed programming, why it's difficult, and I have some facts which I think are really obstacles which I think can be overcome, but which are in the moment stop people from from using depend types in programming. And I have I'm doing good, no? Yeah. I have a last slide. Yeah. So here are, just as a reminder, basically, here my claims is if you want to do strong static typing, and I think you do want to do it, because you have, I mean, it's harder, it's much more work, because the puzzle pieces are really have very precise corners, but you get a potentially huge payback. So you want but if you want a strong static type discipline, I claim you really need depend types. You do want depend types. And depend types are not an additional feature to be added in the end. They are like a fundamental design principle. And I think it's very difficult to say, oh, we have a language. Oh, no, we add depend types. So really, you have to start from scratch or from the beginning. And I do claim that full depend types are feasible and extremely useful for programming. Okay.
We have time for questions, and I know Torsten is looking forward to them.
So you mentioned that partiality is an effect, right? Mm-hmm. Could you just sketch what sort of kind of effect is? Is it a monad?
Yeah, it's a monad. So originally there was a proposal that uses co-induction. It says a partial computation is either a value or later, and you can do later. You can be late as you like. This is not exactly the right solution because you can distinguish the speed. You can observe the speed of a computation. So the paper I have referenced there avoids this. It basically equates things no matter how late they are. Yeah. Actually, from a more, if you know a bit of domain theory, what we do is construct the free omega CPO over a given type. So that's in a nutshell. Category theory, you can always say everything in one sentence. Right? So that's what it is.
Anybody else?
Yes.
It helps if we keep our hands up real high.
You mentioned the difference between total and terminating. Could you expand a little bit more on that?
Yes. Total functions can be functions on stream, which are not really terminating. I mean, you could run them forever if you want to observe the whole stream. I mean, they do terminate, but they're not finished yet. Hence, I would say you want total functions, because with the exception of the examples like interpreters, I think all the programs you write are total. Right? That's very rare that you write that you really want to have a partial program.
It seems to me that if you have a dependently typed program, then for the compiler to decide whether it type checks, it isn't necessarily a decidable problem. Is it decidable, or are there dependently typed programs that are not decidable, whether they are, whether they type check or not?
Yes. So type checking is decidable. It's an important aspect of dependently typed languages. And the main thing which you need is that equality, so what we call definitional equality, is decidable. This is just the normal equality that they have basically the same normal form. It's been the same long beta eta normal form. So in a dependently typed language, there are two equalities. So one is sort of like the static equality, which our programs are really the same, and then there is an equality, more semantic equality, which is called propositional equality, equality types, which is not automatically decidable, right? But they are part, they're just a type, and you have to find an inhabitant of this type to be able, for example, to do this coercion. So yes, it's decidable, but you can express properties and equalities which are not decidable, which require proof, and proof in this case means you have to write a program.
Anyone in this part of the room? Okay.
Somebody here?
Can I make my dependently typed programming language compiler loop forever using a strange type? And if so, what kind of type would that be? Am I doing something wrong if it loops forever, or would that be an honest mistake that one could make, and it would make my life harder?
Okay, so if you're a very principled developer and you never never claim that the program is terminating without the compiler vouching for it, then it cannot loop forever. And I mean, as we just established, type checking is decidable. However, the forever is a very long time, right? And it's very easy to come up with programs which run only until the heat death of the universe for type checking. Yeah, so that may be not a big gain. Yeah, but actually, even in Haskell, you can write programs which have a reasonable size, which also run to the heat death of the universe. So maybe that's not such a point. Yeah. I think in practice, type checking usually is not a big problem. But as I have indicated, there are some issues which have to do with unification problems, which can make the time you need to check your program too much, basically. Yeah.
Thank you, everyone, for your questions. Let's give Torsten a closing round of applause.